knows a lot about all kinds of stuff. Professor Dave Explains.
We've been studying the major classes of linear second-order PDEs. The Laplace equation is elliptic, the wave equation is hyperbolic, and now we turn to the third class, the diffusion equation, which is parabolic. The diffusion equation has the general form partial u partial t equals a times the Laplacian of u, where a is a positive constant. This equation describes systems that generally tend to spread out over time. Two of the main contexts where this PDE comes up are the diffusion of concentrated particles through a medium, hence the name, where U represents the concentration of the particles, and in conductive heat transfer, where U represents the temperature of the medium, and in this context, it's often known as the heat equation. In material diffusion problems, the constant A is known as the diffusion coefficient, and in heat transfer problems, the constant A is known as the thermal diffusivity, which can be related to the more well-known properties thermal conductivity, density, and specific heat capacity. We can also observe that if we assume that there is no time dependence to our solution, so that partial u partial t is zero, the diffusion equation simplifies to the Laplace equation, and so the Laplace equation can be considered the steady state approximation to the diffusion equation. Let's solve the 1D diffusion equation using the hopefully familiar method of separation of variables. We assume a solution of the form u of x t equals capital X of x times capital T of t. Subbing this in and separating the equation gives a second order ODE in x and a first order ODE in t, where we have chosen negative lambda squared as the separation constant. When we solve these ODEs, we find trigonometric solutions in x and exponential solutions in t. Observe that for our temporal function capital T of t, the sign of the exponential is negative, which represents a term that decays in time, which corresponds to the fact that diffusion processes tend to spread things out over time. We can now assign boundary conditions to identify the possible values of lambda and get our solution by superposition of this general solution. Here is an example relating to heat transfer. If we have a one-dimensional metal rod between the positions x equals 0 and x equals L, where L is the length of the rod, and we insulate the rod from the environment along its length but not at its ends, then the temperature distribution u of xt is modeled by the heat equation. Suppose that we give the rod an initial temperature distribution u of x0 equals u0 sine of pi x over L. By subbing in t equals 0 to our general solution and comparing the initial spatial distribution, we find that the coefficient of sine must be u0 and that lambda equals pi over L is the only possible value. Our particular solution is therefore u of xt equals u0 sine of pi x over L times e to the minus pi squared over L squared times at, which takes the form of a stationary half-wave sinusoid that resembles the initial condition but steadily decreases in amplitude with time, falling to zero everywhere in the limit of infinite time. This models the gradual cooling of the bar as heat is lost through its ends, eventually coming into equilibrium with the environment at temperature u equals zero. In the diffusion equation, the gradient of our solution u has its own physical interpretation called the flux. In 1D mass transfer, we can write that capital J, which is the mass flux, is equal to negative A times del u del x, which represents the number of particles passing through a given point x per unit time. In 1D heat transfer, the equivalent property is written as Q, which is the heat flux, representing the thermal energy passing through a point per unit time. These relations collectively are known as Fick's first law, and together with a conservation law for mass or energy for the cases of material or heat diffusion respectively, we can derive the diffusion equation from first principles. The diffusion equation is also quite easy to modify in order to model more complicated phenomena. For example, if we have a body of water where some chemical reaction is taking place, the concentration of the reactant will be subject to both its own natural diffusion through the water as well as its rate of consumption due to the reaction. To capture the dynamics of the reaction, we can add a source term, R, to the right side of our diffusion PDE, where R is a function that represents the rate of production of what we are measuring. In the case of a chemical reaction with U measuring the concentration of the reactant, this term R will be negative since our reactant is being lost. If we were to do a proper analysis of this reaction diffusion system, we would replace R with a known function of U, such as the first order rate equation R equals negative KU, where K is the rate constant, which might look familiar from chemistry. This example of using source terms comes from mass transfer, and an equivalent for heat transfer could be convection to and from the environment, incident or outgoing thermal radiation, or even heat production due to an internal chemical reaction, which would involve a coupled nonlinear system of the heat and diffusion PDEs. Let's check comprehension. Thanks for watching. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials. Support me on Patreon so I can keep making content. And as always, feel free to email me, ProfessorDaveExplains@gmail.com.